one way or another, every single one of you out here. And, you know, it's just great to see so many faces here for them. I mean, me and my mom were pulling in the parking lot. We were trying to figure out, you know, what else was going on here today, because we couldn't believe there were so many cars parked in the parking lot just here to support them. And, I mean, it means a lot. It's really overwhelming seeing so many people here in the sense that, you know, he was so loved, and also the fact that I've, you know, never talked in front of this many people before, but...
And you're doing a great job.
Thank you. Well, I know my mom mentioned earlier, we just wanted to keep it light. We're glad all you guys came in from the Mass and came here, because, I mean, this is what my dad lived for. Free food and an unlimited amount of people to talk to. It's a sad day, but we all want to keep it light, so like she mentioned earlier, we all just want to, you know, tell a few stories, so any funny memories or, you know, just the last thing or, you know, the best thing you remember about my dad that really showed the kind of guy he was, we'd love to have you talk, and my mom's got a few things to say real quick here.
And actually, up until 10 o'clock this morning, I told Kyle I wasn't going to speak. I really didn't think I could. But something happened today that we have to talk about. And all of you who really know Pat know that he was never late to anything. He always told me, if you're on time, you're late, you know, better. So it's kind of ironic that he was late for his own funeral. And it didn't get passed over on me as we were driving here. I'm getting nervous. I'm like, oh my God, it's 11 o'clock. We're not even here. And then I realized he was...
So Pat and I were roommates for several years. He would come home and say, I'd be sleeping, he'd be knocking on my door saying, I got a pizza for us, Joe. So I'd wake up, and before you know it, I had one slice, and he ate the whole pizza on the door. So another time, Pat and I went out to clubs, and Pat ran into a couple of beautiful girls from Lockport or Joliet. Illinois, as I would say to Pat, and I would drive Pat crazy because Pat was always correct on everything. And I would say, Pat, we got some girls from Illinois here. Let's bring them back to the place. So there was three girls, and there was Pat and I.
Thank you.
I'm thinking, this is going to be a good night for us. So we start playing some cards, and Pat and I are sitting on the floor, and the girls are sitting on the couch. Pat rolls over and farts. So he farts, and the girls look at each other, get up and leave. And I say, Pat, that was my opportunity of a lifetime. And so Illinois girls, and then left us. So one of the great things about Pat is he would love to talk, and he would talk all day. And the reason why I think Pat is my brother, because several years, we basically shared the same room. Where we lived in college, we had a house with a pool in the backyard, but they made a big room into two rooms, so we were basically talking all night. And Pat and I would talk and just keep ourselves up all night talking about life things, which I really cherish and miss. When we graduated in 1982 out of Arizona State, our parents came out. And our parents had a good time, and it was great. And our parents were like best friends when they came out. And that was what we were all about. Good people. Our parents saw that we were good people. They became very close after that. Shortly after that, I lost my mom. So what was great about Pat, and this is why there's so many people here and so many people last night, is Pat would reach out all the time to everyone. So after we graduated, Pat would call me once a week. We'd be talking about life things, and Pat then came to New York. And I lived in the Bronx in a sketchy area, and so we went to the Yankee Stadium, which he always wanted to do. We went out to the discos in New York City, which Pat had a little trouble with, but I enjoyed that. So we got back one night around 4:15, 4:30, and I'm in an apartment building, and we're getting ready to go to bed. Pat's sleeping on the couch overlooking the street. Pat looks out the window, and there's a woman picking up a guy for some illegal things, if you know what I mean. So they're across the street doing this. Pat comes into my room and says, Joe, across the street they're doing something. We can't have this happen. I said, Pat, this is just a neighborhood. Let this thing go here. Pat opens the window and starts yelling at these people. Joe, he's yelling at us, stay, stop that, stop that. And that was one thing about Pat, of many things that he was great at. He was the most honest guy in the world. And if he saw something wrong, regardless of the situation, almost too much so, he would let people have it. So I said, Pat, you can't yell at these people, because you gotta know they're gonna know where I live. You're going back to Chicago tomorrow, they're gonna know where I live, and our windows are gonna be broken when we come home from work the next day. He said, I just don't like this happening, which is great about Pat. So, Pat, we all know, had an incredible love for sports. You know, the Bears. So, the last time I saw Pat, he came up to Massachusetts, hung out with us, and I took him to a Pats Bears game, and one of the pictures was us at the game. And Pat, for whatever reason, loved this guy, Jay Cutler, who, to the end of time, Pat would argue that he was the best quarterback ever. And I'm hoping right now Pat can see down and realize that he was wrong with that. But when Pat had something in his mind, you could not get it out of his mind. He would argue to the end of time and all the reasons. I said, Pat, he's sitting by himself on the bench all the time. Nobody comes up and talks to him. That's not a sign of a good quarterback. He says, he's the smartest quarterback ever. Joe, you gotta realize that. He's gonna bring him to the Super Bowl. It didn't happen. I don't know if it ever happened, but Pat's looking down now saying, maybe Joe was right. And he never admitted to me that I was right on things. So, you know, the priest talked about today how Pat's still with us. And over the last 8 hours, I saw five situations where Pat was with us. Fortunately, Vic and I were asked by Donna to stay at the house. And Marty will attest to this. So last night, and I think Mike was there too, we were having a couple pops, and Vic and I, who's, you know, brothers in arms, Vic, Pat, and I were friends forever, started getting into it a little bit, and, you know, at times we'd go outside and not dance, but have a good time together, fighting or whatever it took. But we were getting pretty hot, and I sensed Pat saying to me, in Pat's words, hey, Joe, don't do this. So I got up and I went up to my room. because I felt Pat. So this morning, I woke up, jumped in the shower. Where's Kyle? Okay, so you know what I'm going to say, because I'm going to bring you down right now, okay? And this is so Pat. So I'm in the shower, I come out, doing up my hair, getting ready for the big event today, and I go into my closet and my white shirt is not there. So I looked around, maybe I left it in the car, maybe I left it in the bathroom. I couldn't find it. So I said, Kyle, did you take my shirt? And he said, no. As Pat would fight me with everything. No, I didn't take your shirt. What kind of shirt do you have? What size shirt do you have? What's the brand on your shirt? He's fighting me on this. I don't have a shirt. Kyle lives in the house. He could wear like 10 other shirts, but Marty had brought him a shirt. And so Kyle finally says, okay, let me check with Marty. So he says, Marty, where did you put my shirt? And Marty says, I put it in the other room in the closet. So Kyle says, sorry. As tough as it was for Kyle to say that, I was right. So, you know, today coming in, as I said, Pat was a fighter. When the coffin came out of the hearse, I saw Studley, Sean, Kevin, and Brian stumble holding on to that, especially you, Sean, right? Sean is like this jackmaster bodybuilder in California, I think, that's like lifting all the time. He takes the end of it and he's going like this. And I'm saying, that's Pat fighting. That's Pat fighting to let us all know he's still here. You know, which is really cool. And then the other thing, you know, I was fortunate to sit right behind Don and Kyle at church. Pat didn't like to be touched. So if I knew I was going to get into a fight with Pat, because we like to give it to each other, I would hit him on the leg and say, Joe, what are you doing? And he'd be after me, and before you know it, we'd be wrestling on the ground. And we did have fun doing that. But today, people were coming up and touching the coffin, hitting the coffin, stroking the coffin. And I heard Pat saying, it's okay. Yeah. It's okay, which is nice. So, Kyle, over the years, 35 years, Pat was searching for things in his life. And we all struggle. And if you don't think you struggle, that's wrong. We all struggle for things in our life to find something better. So when Kyle was born, it was all about Kyle. And I know it hasn't been easy because I got three boys and Pat and I commiserated together on the challenges of raising three boys. And it wasn't like we didn't make mistakes in our life, because we made a lot of mistakes. But it's all about having us try to tell you guys not to make the same mistakes. And, you know, right now, you gotta be strong, you know, because Pat's up there. I lost my mother when I was your age, and it sucks. There's no two ways about it. It sucks. But you get through it. You get through it with all these people here. You get through it with Uncle Joe calling you and giving you grief about things you're doing wrong. About you talking last night, oh, I thought about doing tough modern, but that sounds like too easy of a challenge. What did I say to you? I said, I'm going to pay for your tough modern to do the challenge. And then what'd you say? Oh, I don't know if I can do it now. It's like, what are you talking about, Kyle? Do the challenge. Fathers and mothers are all about challenging your kids to take it to another level. And Pat is going to be there every day. You know, the priest today, I thought was a great priest. And all of a sudden, Pat's going to church every Sunday. I didn't know Pat as that. I think that was part of Donna. You know, Pat's going to church every Sunday, 4 o'clock mass, he's coming up. I'm saying, Pat Harper. When I was going to Arizona State, I went to church once a month. Pat laughed at me. Now, he found Donna, and he's going to church every Sunday. So the priest talked about, you go to church and you're closer to people. Well, when my mom died, I started going to church all the time. I became closer to people that have passed away. But also, when you get in a tough situation in your life, you don't need to be in church to talk to him. You know, that's what's really cool. You're going to have him in your life all the time. All right, I got a half an hour left, right? Give me 1 minute. Okay, so I got a lot to talk about Kyle, but I'm going to end it. Now I'm going to end with someone who gave clarity in Pat's life. So, Pat and I have known each other for a long time. We would talk once a week. We talk hours at night, 10:30, 11:30. Things are going so wrong in my life. I can't get things right. And then Donna came along in his life. Donna was the greatest thing in his life, I think. She's shaking her head. But I've known Pat longer than you. I'm his brother and his best friend, so I can say what I want to say. Right? So that's what I'm going to say right now. You know, and it sucks for both of you guys. I'll say that. But you got all these people. You got me driving you crazy all the time. And Kyle, we're here for you. That's what love's all about. And Pat's there every day. So what I'd like to do is just end, because Donna's giving me this, get off the stage. I'd like to end with the Irish blessing. You know, so the Irish blessing goes something like this. May the road rise to meet you, may the wind forever be at your back, and may God hold you in the palm of your hand for the rest of your life. That's where Pat is right now. So thank you. Marty, you want to come up? Donna says you only got a minute because I took a lot of the time, right?
We have plenty of time.
You wonder how they could have been friends with my dad. I mean, I don't know how either one of them got a word in ever.
On behalf of Pat, I'll say, come on, Joe, what are you talking about? Pat Harper, in a nutshell, was all about loving people, caring for people, and putting other people before he put himself. I can attest to that. I ran a turkey trot. I've had, as do many people, I've had health issues with my heart, and Pat was very vocal in me losing weight and getting heart healthy. So back in November, we ran in Schaumburg, what's known as a run called 5K called the Turkey Trot. And there were several family members that ran it. Pat stayed with me by my side through the entire. He could have ran any. Pat was in great shape. Pat was healthy, and he could have ran that race faster than Donna. Donna was, I think, 5 minutes faster than me, but I will catch her the next time. But Pat never left my side through the entire race, and his whole concern was about how I was doing. I think that's how Pat was with everybody. He cared, and that to me, that's Pat's legacy. He cared about everybody, and that's why there's so many people here today, because everybody felt loved and touched by Pat. He was not only a kind person, he's probably the most honest person I've ever met in my life. And sometimes in life, when you're that honest, it may not always politically be correct. While Pat had very strong political opinions, he was not politically correct. And he was the most honest. You never got an answer that wavered or varied in the least. It was straight on, and it was from his heart. And at the end of the day, if you needed a friend, if you were in a pinch, there's nobody better than Pat Harper for being a friend in need. Friend in need is a friend indeed. Pat Harper was my brother, and he was truly a friend to everybody in times of need. I love Pat. I love everything that he stood for, and I love everything about him. And we were just together 2 weekends ago. Came by my house. My wife and my sister and two friends went to a play in Chicago, so we had 3 or 4 hours together. First thing Pat did is he got to the TV in my house and he put on the NFL draft. And we talked about the draft, and he knew every single player. I may have run of 2 or 3. He knew every single player. You know, every college they went to. That was one other thing about Pat. He was a sports almanac. You could ask him who graduated in the 1973 draft, and he could tell you every player and every college they played for. That was a wonderful, wonderful person. And like all of you, I'm going to miss him so very, very much.
And never have I known many things so hard to understand. And never have I questioned more the wisdom of God's plan. But through the cloud of tears, I see the Father smile and say, well done. And I imagine you where you wanted most to be, seeing all your dreams come true. Cause now you're home and now you're free. And we can cry with hope, we can say goodbye with hope. Cause we know our goodbye is not the end. Oh no. And we can grieve with hope, cause we believe with hope there's a place where we'll see your face again. We'll see your face again.
I have three boys. Pat and Donna were like second parents to my boys. And I can't say enough of what Pat did for my family. But on a lighter note, as our boys grew up, I got the privilege of our boys playing sports together, and Pat coaching different sports, from baseball, basketball, football. And back in the time where Don was actually could post up Christian, as opposed to now Christian Sensei. So. But Pat, if you've ever met Pat would shake your hand. He'd have his hand way out here like this, and he'd shake your hand, and then he'd pull you in with a big hug. And then, you know, you knew you were part of Pat. but in coaching, Pat can be pretty intense. And one of the things of being a coach is mentoring young kids and different things, but also being a parent. And sometimes the two are a fine line. And inevitably, in every game that Kyle can attest to, at some point, you would hear Pat giving encouragement or direction to Kyle. And it wasn't very long. It usually was just one word. Kyle! And Kyle would stop, dead in his tracks. What? But the main thing was that he wanted to teach Kyle to drive and strive that other kids could be more physically gifted, more athletic than you are. But if you work harder, and as Pat used to tell me all the time, you choose your attitude and your effort. And if you do that in everything you do, you will go a long way. And Kyle, he has instilled that in you. And if anyone's ever played a sport with Kyle, we used to call him the Bulldog. Because he would get knocked down. He was at our house. Donna probably wanted to pay taxes on our kids because they practically lived at theirs. But our boys would wrestle and fight, and Kyle would get knocked down, Kyle would come back for more. Get knocked down, come back for more. Get knocked down, come back for more. He never gives up. He's instilled that in you and never settle. I think with that Pat right now is smiling, knowing the fact that you're just like what he wanted you to be. And your best days are still ahead of you. I love you, man.
Yeah. I'm Justin Hall. And my dad, he always worked with Pat, so I remember the first time. He's like, hey, I'm working with this guy. His son's going to the same school with you. So he just went and dropped me off right on their driveway and just left me there. I don't really know what to do. And then Pat comes out, just immediately gives me this big hug. He's like, hey, this is my son Kyle. And Kyle just, and I just look at each other and just like, all right, I guess we're friends now. So we didn't even go inside. We just ended up staying and playing basketball the rest of the day. He literally drove my sister and I to school. We carpooled with him to Marion 4 years. Even then, sometimes I still felt like he'd be like, hey, Kyle, I'm going to drive today, just because he wanted to be with us and just have that 15 minutes just to talk with us or just to be there. And I know one thing Father and I were talking about earlier today is the driest humor you will ever see in a person. So dry. Simone and I, it took us 3.5 years to actually figure out if he was being sarcastic or not. You know, and even Kyle, you see that in him all the time. You know, we get in the car and be like, oh, I just saw this great movie yesterday, and it was this movie. And then Kyle or Mr. Harper would be like, oh, that's a great movie. And you'd be looking like, no, it really was a great movie. And he's like, yeah, I know, it was totally great. You're like, oh, okay, so you did like it. Yes, I liked it. All right, thank you. One thing that I'll never forget, and why I feel like so many people are brought in, is for someone as great as him to bring you in and just remember every single person's name, which is sometimes real difficult for people. But the reason why he can do that is because he remembers something essential about each one of us. And that's how he separates you from everybody else. And sometimes that's really hard, but that's how you know that that's a great person. Thank you.
My name's Dave Pittis, and I've known Pat, 15 years or so. And actually, Donna and Mary met each other first. They were on the home board. Next thing you know, we're dragged into doing all this stuff, so we're doing it. But I want to talk about Pat and the dynamics. Now, I'm not going to be sad. I am sad. I'm going to miss Pat. It was a privilege and an honor to be called his friend. And the way he lived his life was an example for me to live my life that way, which is amazing. But I want to talk about three things about Pat that goes from one spectrum to the other. When we first met each other, we went to a movie. And this has got to be the crudest movie I've ever seen in my life. It's called Bad Santa. I don't know if any of you have ever seen it. It's with Billy Bob Thornton and stuff. And as Donna and Mary, some people know, I have a great sense of humor and I love jokes. And a lot of them aren't appropriate. I'm just letting you know that right now. Well, Bad Santa was so disgustingly bad in terms of what they were doing. Me and Pat were so far down in our seats laughing our asses off at what the jokes were, and we were embarrassed that everybody was looking at us. That's how Pat was. Now to go to the other complete spectrum, I lost my son 3 years ago. That man single-handedly would call me almost every day, Dave, how you doing? You gotta get through this, come on, let's do this, let's go, we got this. I'll never forget that, it's invaluable, it's just the most amazing thing. And then his family, he would go, they went on vacation with us. My folks have a house in South Carolina. We go down there. My dad's a paper man. He's got to have paper. Internet, no way. It's got to be black ink, paper, the whole nine yards. Every morning he'd get up at 6:30. Pat would run down there, drive with my dad to the store. They were on an island. Take the dog with it. Pat usually sit in the back because the dog had the front seat. And they would talk all the way there. That's what was amazing about him. He could go from being that jokester on this side to the most loving husband. Donna, he adored you, and that is amazing. And Kyle, I love you, you know that. And I asked Pat in my Facebook post, I said, Pat, look in on us every once in a while. Give my son a hug. And I'm gonna look in on Donna and Kyle every once in a while, and I hope he does the same. Like I said, it was an honor and privilege to be called Pat's friend. Thank you.
Great guy. We got together, married football, and the first thing I noticed about Pat, he's a close talker. You know it. I've seen it in your face, fiddle. So we talk about Montini, and I have to go wash my face. Love him, though, and as our relationship over the last 5 years grew, I kind of was able to give him a stiff arm. He understood what that meant, and he'd back off. Some of the times I thought he was so close he was going to kiss me. I'm like, hey. Funny story, though, we went to the Winter Classic. We went to Ditka's. Our families went. Ditka's pot roast nachos. Got that one. Couple beers. Head to the game. We can't get a cab. The whole city's kind of shut down, so we jump in a bus. So we jump in a bus, and we got a Blackhawk stuff on, and they're playing the Penguins. And here's the guy sitting with his girlfriend, Penguin uniform. I'm looking at him. What are you looking at? I'm looking at you. What are you looking at? You know, Crosby sucks, Kaner's better. Bam, bam, bam. This thing goes back and forth. So I'm like, okay, I guess this is going to happen. So I'm like, man, we're ready to drop gloves on the bus. Seriously, my daughter's all nervous. My wife stops. We're literally going to have a fight. So I turn to Pat. I go, hey, Pat, this is going to happen. You got my back. Because I don't know if I can take that guy. But his girlfriend scares me. So of course, Pat, I got your back. So I'm like, all right, next stop. So door opens up. They scatter. We keep going. And the point of the story is, everyone knows Pat. He's always got your back. Always the shirt off your back. He always backed you up all the time. So short and sweet, and thank you.
Tony Wimber. I was an instant friend of Pat's from the day I sat next to him at a football game. I didn't really know Pat or Donna, and I just said, who's your son? He asked. He goes, that's my son Kyle out there. I go, oh, he's good. Instant friends. You love that. I wanted to share an amazing story that I know maybe some of you know and maybe some of you don't know about Pat. Pat had a passion for his family and the military district. And his great uncle, Jack Redmond, was actually killed on Tarawa. And when the Marines took the beach, he came in and he was shot in the head and buried on Tarawa. And for 70 years, they lost his body. And it's a long story. It has amazing details in it and stuff like that. But one of Pat's passions was to bring his great uncle home. And he knew I was in the Marines, so we talked a lot about this, and he shared things with me. And he called me one day and he says, hey, Tony, there's a body that's buried in the punch bowl in Hawaii, and they think it's my Uncle Jack, but they won't test it. They won't test the DNA because they're not sure, and they don't want to dig it up. Can you help me? And I said, well, I'll do what I can. I called my friends in the Marine Corps, see if they could do it. And long story short, that was not the body. But my friends in the Marine Corps said, we will get on this and see what we can do. And through Pat and through a number of hundreds of people, they found it. And he was buried in the exact same spot he was killed. And on May 16th, they are going to bring him home and bury him. And I credit that to Pat's passion and his drive on this and bringing people together like he did. And my first thought when I heard about Pat was, oh my God, he's going to miss this. But honestly, he is going to have the best view of this. And we're going to be very happy for him, so thanks.
Yeah, definitely a sun devil in heaven today. And there's one thing that I don't have to worry about anymore because Pat was OCD, a little bit like me, trying to always organize a sporting event or who's going to be on the team or whatever at ASU. And we had intramurals and we did basketball, we did football. And the priest today made a comment, he says, they're undefeated in heaven. Thank God, because our intramural teams, they sucked. But you know, in football, Pat used to talk about Lockport High School, and I was like, Lockport, this must be like the Notre Dame of Illinois. This team, that team, we beat this team, and this Catholic team, and this and that. So my first trip to Illinois, I was like, oh God, I gotta go to Lockport High School. I gotta see this. It's gotta be a statue of Pat there, so I'm like, throw him a football, or catch him, football. Then we gotta go to Joliet Community College, because it's gotta be one on that campus too. So we got along because we both failed at playing college football. Well, I think he was much more of an athlete than I was, but I gave up on the sport. We used to just talk about you know, the history of football and all that things. It's sports, of course, one thing after another. I met, are you still talking, Joe? Oh, Joe's finally done, I'm sorry. I knew Joe before I knew Pat. And I'm sure I was studying one night and I met Pat at the library. Maybe not, maybe it was some other stuff with him selling beer. But next day at school, I'm talking to a wall like this. I'm like, you know, just talking to myself. I see another guy talking to a wall. And I'm like, hey, why don't we just talk together? Because we're both talking to walls like we always do. So we talk and we had a good time. So I know you, yeah, it was the other night, whatever. And so we go our way. You know, we're only two guys in the lobby at the business college that afternoon. Why we weren't in class, I have no idea, but we should have probably been. But I knew Joe, and Joe was telling me that he got a new roommate, new apartment, blah, blah, blah. So I'm going to go see Joe's apartment, see if he had any furniture in it or anything like that. Knock on the door, lo and behold, Pat opens the door. I'm like, what a small world. Here's Joe, who's now roommates with this guy I was just talking to earlier in the day. So it was a great way to start a relationship. And the three of us, Donna calls us the Three Musketeers, because our little travel, it was our senior year at ASU when we did most of our damage. So I didn't know our campus at ASU went all the way up to Chicago. Because, I mean, I thought, you know, it was just Tempe, Arizona, but no, it was Chicago, it was New York City, or White Plains, New York, and it was Long Island. So we had a lot of stories to talk about and just explore Arizona and go on trips, go to Vegas, 3 o'clock in the morning, and lose our money in the first hour. And Joe, who knows how to gamble, we feel like give us a chip every day so we can eat and do things. So, but Pat's a great family guy, and in the early days after college, I used to have a job where I'd come from Minneapolis, go down into Chicago, and I'd have like, you know, go see the plant supervisor. Hey, we're done now, 5 minutes. Joe, what are you doing? I mean, Pat, what are you doing? Let's get together. And I look forward to doing that, and he's going through his trials and tribulations, and he meets Donna. I don't have to worry about this guy anymore. Best thing that ever happened, he has Kyle, and he's the best father that you can ever be. I mean, I'm so proud of Pat and Kyle, how he turned out. And Donna, I hope we have a relationship forever. And God bless all you guys for coming here tonight, because Pat, he's in heaven. He's organizing the sports teams. I don't have to worry about that. When we get up there, we'll be doing sports. Thank you. Thank you.
He's married me.
Yeah, I'll marry her. Anyway, I came to Pat's life when Pat was 5 years old. So I've been around all his life. 5 times he called me his big brother. And he felt like my little brother to me too. So there's a lot of stories I can tell you about Pat with his two sisters that I maybe shouldn't tell. I mean, there'd be times we'd be there, my wife and I'd be downstairs in her basement, he'd be sneaking down the stairs. His sister would be yelling, "Mom, get Pat out of here!" You know? And then a lot of times he'd be running around in his underwear. I always call him Little Atlas. And he'd go up, "Mom, Doug, call me Little Atlas again." But Pat, over the years, has evolved. I've been there for many years through a lot of trials and tribulations that he's been through. Kyle is our youngest nephew. All these 4 or 5 tables right up here is all our rhythm. Our side of the family up here. I'm nervous though.
You're doing great.
Pat, as everybody knows, is a sports fan. And you two gentlemen over here talk about Lockport a lot. Well, I went to Lockport myself. And I played football there. And Pat always wanted to be trying to do as best as I did and as Terry's husband did. We were both pretty well established at the football arena there. And he always made sure we were there. And, you know, when we were playing, we'd come over. But you're yelling about Pat yelling at Kyle. My son used to play hockey, and Pat would be at the games, and of course, I was a goalie. And I'd be standing behind my son, he's a goalie, and I'd be yelling at him. Pat come up, "Dog, leave him alone. Quit yelling at him." And my son is only 10 years younger than Pat, so it was like, you know, they were like little brothers together. Anyway, that's a little things I gotta say about that.
Back then, you know, preschool came to an end, and me and Kyle were talking, and Kyle talking to his parents, I talked to my parents, and go, "Oh, there's this kid Kyle. This kid Kyle." I'm like, "Oh, yeah. Where does he live?" And they looked it up, and lo and behold, he was down across the street at the other end of the other cul-de-sac. And I didn't know that he was only, you know, 7 houses away from me. And from then on, Kyle became one of my best friends in the entire world. And from there, Pat was a friend, a coach, another father to me, along with Donna being another mother. And me and my brothers would always go over to see Kyle and play with Kyle. And we would play football, we'd play wolf football, and we were the most competitive brothers in the entire world. We would argue just about arguing. And Kyle would come in and he'd try and calm us down, and then we'd get Kyle riled up. We're all sitting there, we're all wrestling, and one of my greatest memories about Pat was when we played basketball with each other in the Cary League, and we were probably about 7 or 8, and Kyle and I were pretty much the 2 stars on the team, and Pat would start the game, and everyone would go onto the court, and Pat would talk to me and Kyle and be like, "All right, we're going to get a little lead, but I need you guys to pass the ball and share some love." And that was what Pat was about. He always wanted to share the love. He wanted to say hi to everyone. He'd go out of his way. If he saw you on the street, saw you in the supermarket, he'd go out of his way to come say hello and see how you were doing. And with that, with basketball, I know that me and Kyle learned from Pat to share the love. And as he's looking down at us today, and he's sharing the love with us now, I'm going to miss him a lot. I love you, Donna, I love you, Kyle, and I love you, Pat.
It's been incredible hearing all these stories. I mean, you know, it means a lot to hear everyone share the same love for my father that I did, and I know I'm going to carry all these stories with me, you know, for the rest of my life, and it'll be a constant reminder that I'm just the luckiest kid ever to have such a wonderful dad who's loved me so much and has always been there and, you know, made me the man I am today. And And I know we all have a million other stories that we remember my father that we're going to carry with us in our hearts. And, you know, I just can't express enough gratitude to the amount of people that have been here and have been so supportive for me and my mother and the rest of our family and our entire, you know, through this hard time. And it just means a lot. So thank you very much. And, you know, enjoy the rest of your lunch.
We'll see your face again. Cause we believe that everything God promised us is true. So we can cry with hope, we can say goodbye with hope, cause we know our goodbye is not the end. Oh no. And we can grieve with hope, cause we believe with hope there's a place God's grace. There's a place where we'll see your face again. We'll see your face.